Selma Teacher 7, Mr. Barry here. Welcome to the Computer Literacy course. What we're going to be doing today is lesson number one, and I'm going to be going over the quick introduction of what the class is all about and the different locations that I offer this class. So in case if you miss one, you can always take it someplace else to get that same lesson in that week. So you'll be able to find this class on Mondays at the Reedley Senior Center from 1 to 3. You can also find this class on Tuesday mornings at the Jefferson Elementary School from 7:30 to 10:15. And then on Tuesday again in the afternoon at the Selma High School. And that's offered from 3 to 5. And then we also have it at Friday from 5 to 7:30, and that's at the Dunlap Learning Academy. So remember, the classes are offered once per week, so if you miss one, you can always make it up at a different location. Well, let's get started with the lesson. Here's my contact information. I have the two emails there, selmateacher7@gmail.com. You can also find me barry-d@kcusd.net. And I'll give you my phone number there in class. Welcome to the Computer Literacy course. I'm very happy to see you here in the 16-part course, which will develop and fine-tune your computer skills. In this course, we do more than just learn the basics. We will be learning new skills in making our computers more useful in a wide variety of everyday applications, from using them as a means to make free phone calls, to cooking timers, and giving us answers to everyday problems. We will be working with Chromebooks, Windows 10 PCs, smartphones, printers, and other hardware to gain a practical working knowledge of these devices. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Daniel Barry. I received my BA degree in teaching back in 1999. In 2000, I received my teaching credentials in both K-12 and adult education. I have taught computer skills and mouse at his Microsoft Office User Specialist at Sierra Valley College. I'm currently working with both Selma and Kings Canyon adult schools. I also build PCs for the Reedley area. I hope that everyone learns and grows during the unfolding of this course. The skills that will be covered during the course are 1. PC terminology and identification, 2. Windows and Chrome terminology, 3. Windows and Chrome navigation, 4. Program terminology, 5. Program navigation, 6. Email proficiency, 7. Internet navigation, 8. Search proficiency, meaning being able to go online and being able to find exactly what you want to find there. 9. Word processing competence, and also 10. Spreadsheet competence. Other skills and proficiencies will also be covered throughout the length of the course. For example, speeding up Windows and digital camera lessons are also included. Now, if you ever see these little saucers, what they do is they point out special notes, especially during the first few lessons of the class. So whenever you see one, pay attention to what he is pointing out to you. Let's go on to page number 2, PC basics. For today, we will look over the basics of working with a computer. We will look at logging into your computer, the PC mouse, keyboards, opening up an application, the desktop, using the Windows buttons found in the upper right-hand corner of your screens, using Google Chrome to browse the internet, closing applications, shutting down the PC. So let's get started with logging into our computers. Now, computer users need to log in to ensure that they only see and use their own data and apps. This increases the security of their electronic information. So if you had Windows 7 in the classroom or at home, you turn on your computer by pressing the power button. You'd be greeted with a screen like this that you see there, and then you would key in your login credentials. After that, you would see your desktop. If you're using Windows 8 through Windows 10, again, you press the power button. Then you'll be greeted with the login screen, key in your credentials for your computer, and eventually you'll see your desktop. Now, if you have one of the Chrome books, or if you're using one of the Chrome boxes that we just got in at the Senior Center, and what you got to do is you got to turn on your computer by opening up the laptop or by pressing the power button on the desktop as well as the monitor. Then you'll be greeted with your login screen that will look somewhat like we see here. You'll need to key in your Google email address and then your password to log into your specific Google account. That way no one else gets to see your information and you don't see anyone else's information. Once you've done that, you will be greeted with the desktop. Let's go on now to page 3. Let's talk about the mouse that we're using in all the classrooms. Notice that you have a left button, a scroll wheel usually in the middle, and then a right button. The right click will always bring down a special menu. So the mouse is the tool which we can use to navigate through the Windows graphical interface. The PC mouse normally has two buttons, the left and the right one. The left button is used to open up programs and documents. The right one is special because it is used to bring down a context menu from icons and other items. The scroll wheel can be used to scroll down pages. During the lessons, a click is always done by depressing the left button. The right button is depressed only when a right click is called for. On newer laptops, a right click can be done by pressing both fingers down on the touchpad simultaneously. Next, let's look at the touchpad. Some of us are using laptops or Chromebooks in the classroom, so let's look at that too. The touchpad uses the tip of your finger to move the mouse pointer around your screen. The buttons below the touchpad represent the same left and right buttons as on your desktop mouse. If no right button is present, a right click can always be done by pressing and holding Control key and then clicking on the object that you wish to click on. Or you can also just use the two-finger click and click two fingers simultaneously, and that will also bring down a right click menu. All right, let's go on to page number 4 now. And also remember, if you're using this at home or in the senior class, at any time I can pause the video so that everyone can catch up throughout the lessons. Next, we're going to look at the PC mouse. While you control the computer through the use of the mouse, the computer is communicating to you through the mouse pointer. When the computer has received a command from you to start an app, the mouse pointer will change to the busy pointer to let you know that it is busy processing the last command and that you should not click during this time. So let's go ahead now and look at common mouse pointers and what they mean. First off, of course, is the normal select, and that would be looking like this within a Windows machine, on a Macintosh, or on a Chrome OS. It would be looking like here, that you can see black outline. And then if it's working in the background, then it's usually a mouse pointer and a little circle, and that simply means that, hey user, the computer is doing something in the background and that you should wait before clicking again. Next, if you just see the circle, that means the computer is busy. So perhaps you've clicked on more than one application to start up at the same time. The computer is loading up all these apps for you, so that means that you should wait and not click at this time. The precision select is the cross, and usually you only see that when we're working within images, and we'll actually have time to work within images throughout the class lessons. Not today, but in other lessons we'll be working with lessons such as cropping them and editing them in different ways. Next is the text select. So let's say that you're at a web page or within a Word document or a Google document, and you move your mouse over to the page, you would see this icon that looks almost like a capital I, and that simply means text select, and that allows you to type in text into that box. Next, you have your resizing arrows. We'll go over these real quickly. You notice that you have the vertical resize, horizontal resize, diagonal resize, and those simply resize different objects that you have on your screen. So if it's an image that you're working within a document, you can resize that image from the edges. You can also go in and resize different elements on the internet. The next one we have looks like a cross with little arrows on it. That's the move object that allows you to take an object and move it to the next page or to someplace else within the text, such as a picture or a table. Next we have zoom in. And the zoom in can be found at different locations out throughout the internet. Normally we use that to go in and zoom in or zoom out of. If you have a text and it's in a smaller box, you need to go in there, click it, and zoom into it. Being aware of the mouse pointer's appearance as you work with the computer will greatly help you in working more efficiently. Let's now go on to page number 5. We're going to be looking at a special note. If the mouse pointer is too small on your screen, you can resize it and make it larger. If you're working within Windows 7, 8, or 10, all you have to do is click on the Start button, which looks like a little flag. You can also find the Start button by pressing the flag key on your keyboard. So if you look at your keyboard right now, and you look at the bottom of your keyboard between the Control and Alt keys down there by the spacebar button, you'll notice that one key has like a little flag on it. Well, if you press that, that opens up the Start menu. And the same is actually true within the Chrome OS. It will open up a Apps menu. Next, key in the word pointer. Next, select Change the mouse pointer display from the options that are shown to you. And then finally click on pointers and choose the pointer scheme that you wish to use. And when I say scheme, they're showing you different options. So it shows you want large or small or normal. And there's actually a little bit of difference in the displays that they show you, so that it makes it easy to understand once you're there. Just simply click on the size that you feel comfortable with and your mouse pointer will be changed to that size. Now if you're working within the Chrome OS, you can click on the Customize the Control menu. That's one way to do it, and that's by clicking on those three buttons there. Remember, those three buttons are called the Customize and Control menu there, and are normally found always in the upper right-hand corner of your screen. The menu pops down, you want to select Settings, and then key in Large Mouse within the search box, and then select Show Large Mouse Cursor within the options that are shown. Next, let's look at the keyboard. And you notice the little flying saucers there. So apparently I'm going to ask about this keyboard or something about this paragraph at the end of the chapter. Next to the mouse, the keyboard is the most used input device on desktop computers. An input device is any hardware that allows the user, that means you, to enter data into the computer using your keyboard. Whether you are writing a letter, a report, or calculating numerical data, your keyboard is great for entering information efficiently. Your keyboard can also be used to control your computer. For example, with just a few simple keyboard commands, you can do the same tasks as many mouse clicks. The keys are organized according to their function. Let's look at the basics of keyboard operation and go on to keyboard commands. So let's just look at this map that I have here. And as you can see, the keys, they are organized by their function. So notice that we have our alphanumeric keys right here in the center. At the very top, we have the function keys. And then circled for you are the special control keys. If you have a 10 keypad on your keyboard, you'd see that over on the extreme right-hand side, and that's the one with the numbers there. Please note, a USB keyboard and mouse can be plugged into any laptop or Chromebook if the laptop's keyboard is too small or difficult for you to use. So let me show you this in this picture here. Notice at the bottom of page 5, you have a laptop or a Chromebook, and you notice right away I have a USB keyboard, and it's just plugged right in. So any USB keyboard will work with any of your laptops that you may have. And If you so choose, you can also go with a wireless keyboard and mouse, which they sell at different locations for rather cheaply. Usually it's less than $20. Next are special control keys. This is now on page 6. The first key I want to look at the very top is the F1 key. That's how we find help. Next is the escape key. That usually will close off certain windows. Then we have the control key. The Windows key is the one with the little flag on it, and then the Alt key. And again, that's mirrored on the other side of the keyboard, on the other side of the space bar. And we also have that all important Delete key. One option here that you have too is the Backspace key, which is usually above it, over to the side. And that Backspace key allows you to delete things as well. Okay, now let's look at our little table that I've created for you. And let's look in detail here. The Alt key shows menus options when used by itself. When used with other keys, it can select those options. The Control key, by itself, it does nothing. However, when pressed with other keys, it can open and set other options for you. Control Alt Delete key combination, you press those all at the same time. This opens your task manager. Next is your Delete key. It deletes files, folders, and selected text. One thing I want to add to this is the backspace key does the same thing. So if I highlighted a paragraph or an image, and I hit that backspace key, I would expect it to be deleted just as if I hit the delete key. Next is the escape on my table. It closes off dialog boxes and opened menus. F1 will always open the help menu. So if whenever you need help on a certain task that you're performing, whether it be printing or working within a document, you can always press F1 and then look down the options for help. Windows logo is the last one I talk about in today's lesson here. And the Windows logo will open up your start menu. Now these special keys act like shortcuts and save you a lot of time when used in the right combination. Now we're going to look at a special trick. This trick can be used in Windows machines, but we don't usually use it in the Chrome OS. This is the Alt-Tab trick. You may switch between open programs or apps within Windows by using the keyboard shortcut Alt-Tab. The Alt-Tab shortcut is done by pressing and holding the Alt key, and it is found near the lower portion of your keyboard near the spacebar. As you're pressing the Alt key, press the Tab key once, like this. The Tab key is found on the left-hand side of the keyboard. If you have two or more programs that are running, a new window will be opened in front of your work, and it'll look just like you have here. So notice this means that I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five different applications that are opened. And I press the Alt Tab, and I should be able then, whenever I hit that Tab key, the active window or the window that's in front of all your work will change. The Alt Tab is great and a fast way to switch between open apps. And notice it's a flying saucer, so I will ask you this question at the end of the chapter. Next we have getting to know the keyboard on a Chromebook. Now many of us in class, the student says, they have Chromebooks. And he said, well, hey, the Chromebook keyboard is a little bit different. I want to go over them. So I added this page just for you all. And in some of my classrooms, we use nothing but Chromebooks throughout the entire semester. The design of your Chromebook is a little different from traditional notebooks. The first difference that you'll notice are the function keys on the top, which serve as shortcuts to common tasks. So right here we see the escape key. Escape will interrupt or cancel the current process or running program or close a pop-up window. It's very similar to what we have in Windows, by the way. It does basically the same thing. Then you have the back and forward keys. The arrow keys allow you to go back and forth to previously visited web pages. The refresh key will refresh the web page being viewed. Next is this key here. This key will enter and exit full screen mode. So if you look at my screen right now, I'm using full screen mode on my desktop. So you don't see my desktop icons, you don't see the start button or the app launcher at the bottom of my screen, and you don't see other tabs opened. All you see is the active window. That's what I press to get to that place there. That's called full screen mode. Next, you see a little sun and a big sun. These keys will dim or brighten the display for you if you're using a laptop or a Chromebook. Next, we have the keys that look like little speakers. These keys control the volume settings for your speakers. And the very last button is the power button. If you press and hold that button, it will shut down your Chromebook, so that the next time you open up the clamshell, you'll need to log in by username and password into your machine. Next, let's talk about just the total layout here of your keyboard. So notice that the function keys were at the top, then you have the number keys, and then the alphanumeric keys are there, and then special control keys are around. Some Chromebooks do not have a caps lock key, and instead of function keys, you have dedicated keys for managing the Chrome browser. Getting used to this may take a little while, but once you know your way around, I am sure you'll enjoy it, which I know I do, and I'm able to create all of my lessons and the book that you see before you. I created all that within a Chromebook, or different Chromebooks here. The search key and the caps lock key, so let's talk about those, because there is a caps lock key there, it's just a little hidden. The caps lock key has been replaced with the search key, which opens the apps menu. The apps menu is used to as the same way as the start menu on a Windows PC. When you need the caps locked on, just use the following shortcut. You press Alt and then the search key, as you see in this image that I have for you here. So it's Alt and the search key, and that locks the caps on for you. Then whatever you type in, it's capitalize. To turn them on, just do the exact same shortcut, Alt, search, and it turns off the caps lock for you. When caps lock is on, you'll also see a small icon at the very bottom of your desktop there next to the time, and you'll be right on your taskbar. There's no delete key on your Chromebooks. So yes, there's no delete key now. And here's the shortcuts for it to be used instead. Now, as we said earlier, just on the previous page there, you can just go backspace if anything is highlighted, and that will delete it outright. But let's say that you want to do a forward delete, which is a little bit different, deleting the items in front of you, in front of your text or your insertion point. You press Alt and you hold it, and you tap the backspace key, and you'll see your mouse pointer move. Actually, it'll go this way for you, and it'll be deleting the words in front of the insertion point or the cursor. So that's called the Alt backspace shortcut. If you want to delete the previous word, just use backspace by itself, and it deletes previous spaces there. Now, how to instantly see all of the Chromebook keyboard shortcuts? Well, all you have to do is use the shortcut. It is Control Alt and then that little dash there. Many times people say it's Control Alt question mark because it's easy just to say that. So again, you press those three keys simultaneously, but normally you can press Control first, just a tenth of a second before you press the others. So Control Alt and you tap that question mark and you let go of all of them in an instant. And what will show before you is a shortcut of all of the keyboard shortcuts that you have there. It'll be listed on your screen. If you want that to go away, you simply press the escape key and the shortcuts go away. And I'll show you that here in class with my Chromebook and let you actually play around with that. You can use a USB keyboard into your Chromebook if you prefer using the traditional keyboard layout. So if you're not happy with the way things look on your keyboard, no problem. Just plug in a keyboard and you're off. Let's go on now to page 9, Common Mouseless Shortcut Table. I'm not going to read off all of these, but I'm just going to go over the most important ones. Remember, every student has this in their handout, so you can use this when you get home. If you press Control and you hold it, and then you tap the A key, it highlights or selects all the items within the window. So if there's text, images, and a table, it will highlight all of that text for you. If you want to open the Start menu, another way to open the Start menu is Control Escape. To open a new window, it's Control N. To send a document to your printer, it's Control P. To copy the selected text or image, it is Control C for copy. And then to paste that selected text or image into another document or to another location within your document, it's Control V. And then if you want to cut out the selected text, it's Control X. If you want to delete the selected item or text, it's Control D. Undo the last action. You say, oh no, I deleted the wrong thing. We just go Control Z, as in zebra, and that will undo your last action. And you can actually have multiple levels of the undelete. So I can go Control Z, 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 and just keep on pressing that Z or tapping that Z, and it will undo your steps one by one. You can use the arrow keys to switch between open apps, and you can do this by going Control Alt Tab. That was one of the tricks that we learned today. Change the size of the icons on the desktop. That's Control and then the scroll wheel. So if your desktop items are too small, hold down the Control key and then use that scroll wheel up or down, and that'll make items larger or smaller right in front of your screen there. You can also use the Tab key. This usually cycles within the active elements. And I'm not going to go through the rest of them here because that gives you many, many options there to study those in detail at your home there. But notice that we have those printed for you. Next, these shortcuts work on Windows PCs and your Chromebooks. So whatever you're using, you can use these keys. Even if you plug in a traditional keyboard into a Chromebook, again, F1 will always bring up help, even on a Chromebook, you can do that. So by using these keyboard shortcuts, you can open the Start menu and open any application without using your mouse. You can also find help by pressing the F1 key, no matter which app you're using. Let's now go into page number 10 and look at the desktop. Once the computer has started up or booted, you will see the desktop. The desktop holds all of our icons and may even display a background photo for us. So notice, if you press the power button, you see the splash screen, which tells you which operating system you're using, and then your desktop usually appears sometime after that step. The desktop is the main screen area that you see when you turn on your computer and log into Windows. It has been around since Windows 95 and has grown to include many new and helpful features in later versions of Windows. It behaves like an actual desk and holds your work. When you open programs or folders, they appear right on your desktop. You can also put things on the desktop, such as files and folders, and arrange them however way that you want. So here we see a Windows 7 desktop, in case you still have a Windows 7 at home. You notice you have your recycle bin and other applications are situated there, their icons. Your Start menu is towards the bottom left, and over on the bottom right you have your notification area that usually has your time and other important icons there. You may have gadgets on a Windows 7, and they would be showing you up in the upper right hand corner. The task bar is that bar that runs along the bottom of the screen. In Windows, we call that the task bar. In other applications or other operating systems, it has a different name. But this is learned that first name here. Task bar is the bar that runs along the bottom, and that's its name for within a Windows OS. Now let's look into Windows 10 on page 11. It looks very, very similar. You have icons to your applications on your desktop. At the bottom left-hand corner, you have the app launcher or the Start menu. Something that's a little bit different in Windows 10 is you have this special little area where you can click in there and type in a question, such as if you say weather or something else, you can look up the weather for you. If you click on the microphone, you just speak your question into the microphone and it prints out the question there and it'll answer your question as best as it can. Here we see our taskbar again at the bottom, and we see applications at the bottom there. Your notification area is on the lower right-hand side, just like it was in Windows 7. And again, you have your time and other important icons there. Let's now look at a desktop found on a Chromebook. And here we see the app launcher, so that's its name. We don't call it the start menu on a Chromebook. It's called only the app launcher. And at the very bottom here, we have applications. And then you have your notification area, and then your control center. So again, you have important areas found in the lower right-hand corner there. Let's now go to page 12. Let's talk about app shortcuts. You'd have your icon for your application, and you click it, and it take you to the shortcut of your app. So it's kind of like non-locality, where two items are linked together, or hyperlinked together. So when you click on this one behaves. You see, even though it may be in a different location, perhaps it's not on your desktop, it's on a folder, on a hard drive, or it's in an app within your Google account. You click this one icon, yet this application starts. Icons represent apps. They are normally not the apps themselves. This is good to remember when you wish to delete or uninstall an app, which we will discuss at a later lesson. Now let's look at that bar that runs across the bottom of your desktop. In Windows, it's called the taskbar, and on the Chrome OS, it's called the shelf. The taskbar or shelf is that long horizontal line that runs along the bottom of your screen. It holds a start menu or a start button and app launcher on the left, and the system tray or notification area on the right. In the middle, it shows you the programs which you are using at that time. When a program is minimized, it moves to the taskbar. To open it again, just click it and it will be restored to its normal size. Within Chrome OS, Windows 7, 8, and Windows 10, you may add shortcuts of your favorite programs on the taskbar simply by right-clicking the program or application icon and then selecting Pin to the taskbar. And here we see the system tray or notification area. In Windows, you notice it looks like this. And over here in the Chrome OS, it looks like this. The system tray or notification area holds the icons for Wi-Fi connectivity, battery usage if you have a portable device, the time and date. It also acts as a shortcut to many of the computer's settings. Important notification icons and what they mean within Windows. So if you see this battery, it says normal battery charging. So it's a battery with a plug on it. Normal battery draining looks like this. Update is available, so that would be a Windows update. It'll look like this icon. No network or network error. It'll look like this. Have that little red X in it. Connected to Wi-Fi. It'll look like this, like why the little arrow there, or the waves are moving and there's no X on them. Notification icon usually looks like a little carrot or an arrow pointing up. Within the Chrome OS, we have the normal battery charging. It's a battery with a little lightning rod through it. Normal battery draining usually shows a battery and it's draining from the top down. Update is available. So if you have a Chrome update that is available, you'll see a black arrow pointing up. No network or network error. Well, that's where you see this fan with an X through it. And if you're connected to Wi-Fi, again, the fan is there, but now you have white areas or white sections that are filled in that fan. And the notification icon looks like a bell. Let's now go on to page number 12. Within Windows 7 and 10, you have the arrow peak. This shows the desktop. So whether you're on the internet or within another application and you just want to see the desktop real quickly, simply click on this little area that's to the right of the time. Please note that you can change the time found within the notification area simply by right-clicking it and then selecting Adjust Time. The Start menu and the App Launcher. So let's talk about these two here. Here's the Windows 10 Start menu, as we see here in the first box. And you notice that when you click it, you'll see your applications here. Most used apps are found here. And you simply start them by clicking them. You also have shortcuts to commonly used applications or other elements that are found here on the other side. Within the Chrome OS App Launcher, you click it and you'll get this, normally this little square window opens up. You can search in there. You can also, if you use those keywords, okay, and then the word Google, you'll do a verbal search for you. So you simply ask for the app that you want to find and it brings it for you. Or you can click on it down here. And if you don't see the app that you want to use, simply click on All Apps and it shows you a longer list there. So the Start menu or App Launcher is the main gateway to all of the applications on the computer. It is called the Start menu or App Launcher because it is the first place where most users begin their task of opening their applications. The Start menu App Launcher has a search box to find apps, documents, or even internet content. Just key in a word that is found within the document that you're looking for and it will bring it up. It also can show you the local weather. So here's on my Chromebook. If you just scroll down the list, it shows you usually current weather right there. Let's now move on to page 14. Using the Windows buttons found in the upper right-hand corner. The first button looks like a minus symbol. It will minimize the application to the bottom of your screen, right, usually in the taskbar or within the shelf. The second button is the Restore or Maximize button. It will cause the application to either take up less space, that is we call Restore, or take up the entire screen, which we call Maximize. The last button is the Close button. This button will turn off the application. Ooh, you have a little UFO, so I'm going to ask you about this here at the end of the chapter. You can also use the shortcut Alt plus F4 on the keyboard to turn off any application. These Windows buttons can be found on most of all of the applications that you might use. So use them to your advantage. With these buttons, it is possible to see more than one window at one time. Now to see multiple windows on one display, what you can do on a Chromebook is if you minimize this, drag this window any size that you want to. So you could go in and open up a new tab and then drag that outside of the group. And notice now you have a second one there. And I can drag that to fit half of my screen. I can then click on my main lesson and then drag this over. So now I can have be reading my lesson and doing the work at the same time. So that's one way to do this. If you wanted to watch the video and do the lesson, you can also do it that way. On a Windows machine, you can hold the flag key down, and then if you use the arrow keys, like let's say we want to use the flag arrow, and it goes over like this, and it'll take over one side, and then you can just choose which one that you want, which window you want to be on this side. So if I want to have the new tab, I just simply click it and then it fills up that half. Our next topic that we're going to be talking about is using the Google Chrome web browser. So first, start the Chrome browser by clicking on its icon, which looks like this. Please note, if you do not have the Chrome browser on your computer, you can download it for free. You can find it from www.google.com. Once Chrome opens, you may log into your Chrome account if you are using it on a Windows device. If you are using a Chromebook, you already logged in to your account. Logging into your account allows you to see your bookmarks, your favorites, and all of your data, such as email, documents, and your applications. Let's go on now to page 15. Using the Chrome browser to find information on the internet. The internet can be used to find almost any information which you think of. This is normally done by going to a search engine and keying in the search criteria. Number one, let's follow these steps and go in through there. Now I can pause the video here in class and help people as they're logging into their account or doing the search for the very first time. So, open the Google Chrome browser by clicking on its icon if you have not done so already. Number two, once Chrome is up and running, click within the address bar found in the upper part of the screen or the window. So I'm going to circle it on the overhead right now. So it's right there. It's a long white bar at the very top of your screen. And it normally has a little search icon next to it as well. When you click once within the address bar, the text becomes highlighted. You may enter in the new address simply by keying in it on your keyboard. Type in Google within the address bar, and then you can use the shortcut Control plus Enter to go straight to that website if it is not already there. So on some of the computers, you already start at google.com. But if you're at a Selma Unified School District website and you use that, then this is how we can go from the school site to the Google search engine. Again, you just type in Google into the box and then hold down the control key and tap the enter key once, and it'll add the www and the .com for you automatically. In many cases, you don't even have to do the shortcut control enter. You just go Google and hit the enter key and it takes you to that website as well. So now you know two ways to go to websites. Number five, if the computer is on the net, then the Google search engine will be displayed. Notice that the Google search page has a text box in the middle of the page. What we want to do is click in there and then key in cheapest books within that search box. Then hit the enter key once, found on your keyboard. Number eight, a new window should now open, displaying the search results. Number nine, you may click on any link to view that website. Remember, to go back to the search page, just click the back button that is found on your browser. It's a little arrow that faces see a little star up there? Well, you can actually add web pages that you are interested in by clicking on the small star found within the address box. You can see a little yellow star up towards the top right hand portion of your screen. If you click it, it automatically adds that page to your favorites or your bookmarks. To change the settings or appearance of the browser, click on the Customize and Control menu icon, which looks like three small dots, and it's to the right of the small star. Next page, how to close an app. To close an application, click on the X found in the upper right-hand corner of the window. Note, programs may also be closed by pressing the Alt and F4 keys. This is called the Alt F4 shortcut. Shutting down the PC. When wishing to turn off a PC within Windows, follow these steps. Click on the Start button and then select Shut Down. If the PC has been set up to turn off with the Power button, you may also simply turn off the computer by pressing the Power button once. You may also shut down a PC by using that shortcut Alt plus F4. Here's a pro tip. To set the power button to turn off your PC in Windows 7 or 10, if it's not already done so, click the start button or the start screen and then key in the words, change what the power buttons do. And click on that option and follow the on-screen instructions to allow the power button to work as a turn off button. So that is a pro tip for all my experts out there. You can change that, what the power button actually does. You can make it go into hibernation, sleep, or power the machine down all the way. To power off your Chromebooks, press the power button once. On some Chromebooks, you may need to press and hold the power button for 5 times to shut down the device. You may also just close the clamshell to turn off the school's Chromebooks. Now, I've added Android into this lesson because some of the students actually bring in their Android tablets to do all of the schoolwork right there. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Android here momentarily. Android is an operating system that runs many tablets, smartphones, and even a few laptops and desktop computers these days. So let's look at the Android desktop. You'll notice that you have applications, and these are icons to our commonly used apps. You have an app launcher found in the lower center of the screen. You have a back, home, and then multiple apps view button to see multiple apps at one time. If you look at the top of your screen, you'll notice it says notification area here. On the top right-hand corner, that is, it's showing you the notification area for Wi-Fi connectivity, how much battery you have left, and normally the time. On the top left, you have other notifications, such as any emails that you received recently will appear there. Let's now go on to page 17, but before I do that, I can pause the video in class and answer any questions that we have for this lesson before going on to the question and answer time. Okay, welcome back everyone. Hopefully we're now ready for page number 17, which is the review questions for lesson number one. What I'd like you to do is take out a clean sheet of paper, write your name along the top line. After answering these questions, you would wish to turn them in to me, Mr. Barry. Please write out your answers on a separate sheet of paper too. Number one, what does the function key F1 do within Windows? Alrighty, hopefully you've written that down. Number two, what kind of click will bring down a special pull-down menu out of an item? Number three, what is the name of the mouse pointer shown here in this box? Number four, what things are found on the taskbar? Number five, how do you change the time found in the notification area? Number six, what is the mouseless shortcut to switch between open applications and programs? Okay, number seven, what is the shortcut used to close an app or an application? Number eight, how may the computer communicate to you? Number 9, what does the Alt plus F4 shortcut do? We often call just the Alt F4 shortcut. So what does that do? Number 10. What icon do you use to change the appearance or settings of your Chrome browser? Number 11. What does this mouse pointer do or mean? And by the way, it looks like a circle going around and around. What does that pointer mean, or what's the name of it? Number 12. What is an input device? You can give me the definition that I gave you in the lesson, or even name an input device. Number 13, what do you click on to add a bookmark to the Chrome browser? Number 14, what do the three dots found in the upper right-hand corner of the web browser mean? Number 15, what does the Alt-Tab shortcut do? Number 16, how are the keys on the keyboard organized or arranged? We're now going to have the review terms for lesson number 1. The first one is app. It is a self-contained application or program. It's a piece of software designed to fulfill a particular purpose. Desktop. It is the workspace on a computer where apps can be accessed and work is organized. Browser. An application with a graphical user interface for displaying HTML files used to navigate the World Wide Web. Input devices. This is any device that allows the user to input information to your computer. So common examples for an input device would be a mouse or a keyboard. Operating system. Also known as OS, is the software that controls the computer's basic functions, such as executing applications, hardware behavior, and interfacing with the user. Every computer has an operating system. Common OSs are Windows XP, Windows 7, Windows 8, Windows 10, Chrome OS, Android, Ubuntu, and even Mac OS. All of these operating systems have a desktop, an app launcher, and a way to alter their appearance. Output devices is next. Any device that allows the user to receive information from the computer. So a good example of this would be your monitor. And next is USB. Universal Serial Bus. It's a way of connecting peripherals such as mouse, keyboard, printer to a computer. Now, if you're watching this on YouTube, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you haven't done so already. Now remember, this is just the first of the 16 lessons, so this is just the groundwork, the basics, because all these lessons build upon each other. So the next lesson will be lesson number 2, where we're going beyond the basics, beyond these things that we've covered here. Thank you very much and have a good day.